sing, low in the grave he lay. Somebody around you, and then I'll open us with the scripture reading today. So welcome. Take a moment to greet somebody around you.
Thank you.
And to begin our time today, we just want to read the amazing truth of the resurrection to remind us what happened early that Easter Sunday morning. Two passages I want to read for you before we pray today. The first is from Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, and I'll read for you verses 1 through 12. And the text says this: very early that Sunday morning, the women made their way to the tomb, carrying the spices they had prepared. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Jesus' mother Mary. Arriving at the tomb, they discovered that the huge stone covering the entrance had been rolled away. And so they went in to look, but the tomb was empty. The body of Jesus was gone. They stood there stunned and perplexed. And suddenly two men appeared above them in white robes, shining like lightning. Terrified, the women fell to the ground on their faces. The men in white said to them, "Why would you look for the living one in a tomb? He is not here, for he has risen. Have you forgotten what he said to you while he was still in Galilee? The destiny of the Son of Man is to be handed over to sinful men to be nailed to a cross. And on the third day, he will rise again." All at once, they remembered his words. Leaving the tomb, they went to break the news to the 11 and to all the others of what they had seen and heard. And when the disciples heard the testimony of the women, it made no sense and they were unable to believe what they heard. But Peter jumped up and ran the entire distance to the tomb to see for himself. Stooping down, he looked inside and discovered it was empty. There was only the linen sheet lying there. And staggered by this, he walked away, wondering what had been. May God bless the reading of his word today. We want to take a moment to pray, and then I'm going to ask two of our ushers to come, and we'll receive the offering and have a time of meditation before this amazing choir leads us in a beautiful cantata today. Choir, are you ready today? I know you've worked so hard, and our prayers are with you as you present this message to us through song. Before we pray, just one quick announcement. Due to it being Easter, we do not have any nursery or any child care available today. We wanted everyone to be together, and so we invite you to enjoy what the choir has prepared for us. And as I pray, if our ushers will come, will you bow with me for you, please? Our Father in heaven, we are grateful for the resurrection. We are thankful that Jesus is alive. Lord, we are grateful for your word. For your word says that death could not keep him. The grave could not hold him. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for conquering death and conquering the grave. Thank you for giving us the greatest hope of heaven, the greatest hope and assurance of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, we bow before you, and as we have come through this past week to remember a Maundy Thursday and a Good Friday, just as we observed here in those services, Lord Jesus, we just want to thank you for dying for our sin. Thank you for bearing our sin upon the cross. Lord, we don't fully understand why or how you could love us that much. Lord, even for the worst of sinners, you died. For every time they beat you, Lord Jesus, for every time the soldier spat upon you, for every nail that pierced your beautiful hands and feet, Lord, we thank you. And Father, even though the enemy thought he had won, even though the enemy thought that death had somehow conquered your son, Lord, we thank you that it was in your perfect plan. in the plan of your salvation that you provided for every one of us here, that as a part of your plan on that third day, very early that morning, that a miracle would happen that had never been seen or experienced before, that Jesus Christ became alive and was raised powerfully from the dead. Lord, we are grateful that the book of Romans teaches us that that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that is available to all who would repent and believe today. Father, as we worship this morning, help us to do just that, to repent and believe. Would you bless now this time of offering and giving? Would you bless, Lord, the choir as they lead us today? Thank you for all of the choir, for Joe and for Fred and for the narrators and for all that are making today possible. We pray your blessings over this service, and we ask it in Jesus' name, and all of God's people said together. Amen.
the echo of a timeless theme is heard throughout all the earth. Before anything was created, and to this very day, you can hear it in simple gatherings and in grand cathedrals. The message, the majestic hymn of angel and millions of blood-bought saints, resound with the unshakable statement of faith. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Jesus Christ is Lord.
Jesus Christ is Lord. No greater declaration has ever been heard. To a world desperately seeking answers and frantically searching for truth, we have this message. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Early Christians greeted one another with these words. For the atoning death of Jesus and his triumph resurrection were their cause for celebration and the central theme of their life. And still today, Christ's victory over the grave offers the promise of eternal life for all who will call on him.
Long ago the plan was formed. Jesus, God's Son, would become a man. He would suffer and die for our sins, then rise victorious and ascend to his Father's throne. He is there even now, speaking on our behalf, interceding to the Father, for you, for me.
To the Father for his children.
is Christ. We exalt as the Lord has bridged the gap between a holy God and a sinful human race. For centuries, godless lambs have been offered as atoning sacrifices for the sins of the people of God. These, however, were merely symbols of the one perfect Lamb who cleanses by his only blood.
God's word tells us that the only through the shedding of blood is the forgiveness of sins. So Jesus, the Lamb, became our sacrifice.
Thank you. I will tell the wondrous story
frightened and confused, they must have felt as if they were all part of some cruel dream. Has Jesus' ministry been a hoax? Were his words of wisdom and promise all lies? Their hopes had been dashed. Their world had been torn apart. His friends could only stand by and wonder how their master, the one they believed to be the Lord of life, could now lay silent in a cold, dark tomb.
But death could not hold him, and the grave could not contain him. Early in the morning of the third day, love's redeeming work changed songs of sadness to outbursts of joy. The bleakness of death gave way to the miracle of life. He had risen. the good news of the gospel, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, is more than just historical fact. This powerful reality still changes lives today.
Once before his crucifixion, Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I am?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets."
"But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say that I am?"
Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Christ went on to say that he would build his church on this one great truth, and the gates of hell itself would not be able to stand against it.
And for all of us, that question still remains. One by one, we must hear and answer the words of Jesus, the Son of Man. "Who do you say?" Saints resound with the unshakable statement of faith. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Jesus Christ.
Was arrested and going through his trials and traveling through the courtyard, the text tells us in Luke 22, verse 56, that there was a girl who noticed Peter sitting in the firelight. And staring at him, she pointed him out, saying, "This man is one of the disciples." The Bible tells us that Peter fully denied it, saying, "What are you talking about? I do not know you. A little while later, someone else spotted Peter and said, wait, I recognize you. You are one of his disciples. I know it. A second time, Peter said, I am not one of his disciples. About an hour later, someone else identified Peter and insisted and said, look at him. He is from Galilee, just like Jesus. I know he is one of them. Peter, for a third time, was adamant. And he said, listen, I do not know what you're talking about. Don't you understand? I don't even know him. And then something happened to Peter, because the Bible says that at that moment, on that third time that Peter denied Jesus, it says in Luke 22, verse 61, at that moment, the Lord, who was being led through the courtyard by his captors, turned around and gazed at Peter. And all at once, Peter remembered the words that Jesus prophesied over him. Before the rooster crows in the morning, you will deny three times that you even know me. The Bible says that Peter burst into tears and ran off and wept bitterly. Can I ask you today, like Peter prior to the resurrection, can I ask you, have you denied Jesus? Like Peter, have you been caught in the midst of that circumstance where someone looks at you and says, I know that he or she is a follower of Christ, and yet, like Peter, have you denied him? I want you to know that just as the Bible says the Lord turned around and gazed at Peter, so today the Lord is gazing at you. The Lord is gazing at you, and it could be like Peter that some of us today need to weep bitterly and experience in deep, genuine repentance that we too have denied the Lord. I read this week that Judas betrayed him for 30 pieces of silver, and yet how many of us betrayed him for free? But something happened to Peter on that resurrection morning. In Luke chapter 24, verse 12, we read it earlier, that Peter jumped up and he ran the entire distance to the tomb. And the Bible says this, that he ran to see for himself, the Bible says, stooping down, he looked inside and discovered that it was empty. And today, like Peter, some of us need to stop running away from the tomb, and we need to start running to the tomb. And like Peter, we need to step inside and look and see for ourselves that Jesus Christ is alive. And then after the resurrection, over in John's Gospel, the next time we read about Peter after he left that tomb, still, I'm sure, feeling quite shameful over his denial. And by the way, if you feel some shame in your life today, can I tell you that after the resurrection, Jesus restored Peter. And if you need restoration in your life, if you need to be made whole and to be made new, Jesus can do that for you as Jesus did for Peter. Because over in John's Gospel, you remember the story. Jesus appeared on the seashore as the disciples were fishing. And the Bible tells us that after they had breakfast, Jesus looks at Peter. Remember those same eyes with which Jesus gazed at Peter after he denied him three times. Those same eyes of the resurrected Christ look at Peter, and three times Jesus asked him, "Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me? Peter, do you love me?" And I want to tell you today that just as Jesus restored Peter, so today your life can be restored. So today, your life can be renewed. So today, just as the resurrection changed the life of Peter, can I tell you today that the resurrection of Jesus can change you. The resurrection of Jesus can make all things new. The resurrection of Jesus can cleanse you and make you whole. I invite you today, as we close this service, to let the resurrection of Jesus change you. The resurrection changes things. Amen, choir? Jesus changes lives. Jesus restores marriages. Jesus sets free from addiction. Jesus heals from heartache. The resurrection of Jesus can change you. And I invite you during these next couple of moments of invitation, I'll be up front to greet you. I invite you today, if you never trusted in Jesus, to do that just today. I would love to pray with you. This altar will be open. And I invite you to stand now as we enter into a time of invitation. If you would please stand with me. And every head bowed and every eye closed, would you listen to 60 seconds of the truth of the words of this song and exactly what Peter knew, that he's alive. Would you bow with me and listen? house of the Lord this Easter Sunday. Would you say amen?
Amen.
Choir, thank you again so much. We invite you to join us downstairs for a light coffee bar and fellowship together. Also, our children and youth will be having and enjoying an Easter egg hunt together. So if you have time to stay, please stay and join us downstairs. And our Sunday school classes will meet as usual. I leave you today with this benediction from the book of Romans, chapter 1, verse 16. Go now in the wonderful message of God's liberating power unleashed through Jesus Christ our Lord. God bless you today. Have a happy Easter. Thanks for being with us.